Sci-fi sensation for the next hour and a half here on BBC Three as the first episode of Farscape hits our screens in half an hour. After, of course, we go Doctor Who confidential.
I can't quite believe it's actually back.
I think he's an alien from another world.
Ready for this? Here we go. History.
I came back to the BBC as head of drama at BBC Wales, and it was my first meeting with Jane, the drama commissioner, and she just came out with it and said, how would you feel about bringing back Doctor Who?
I read in the newspaper that Russell was going to write Doctor Who, and it was really intriguing to me.
We did have loads of people that we were thinking about, but Chris was always in our heads.
I would never approach Chris Eccleston in a million years, I don't think. I wouldn't have thought he would be interested.
I like the idea of a writer as intelligent and rigorous as Russell writing for children, because I think, you know, if you can get them young with good stuff, as they grow older, they're going to demand good stuff of their television.
We just wanted someone who would be a brilliant actor and would surprise the audience and not be a predictable choice.
And then I got an email off him. Literally, he'd been out for a jog and he said, I've been thinking about Doctor Who and, you know, if you don't mind, can I put myself on the list?
When I heard it was Christopher Eccleston, that really came out of left field, I was overjoyed.
He's a marvellous actor, got a great track record, and I'm very excited that he's doing it.
Christopher Eccleston was by no means the most obvious choice. But as soon as we saw him audition, he just played it in such an interesting way.
I'm the Doctor, by the way. What's your name?
Rose.
Nice to meet you, Rose. Run for your life.
Rob.
The Doctor is a legend woven throughout history. When disaster comes, he's there.
Fantastic. You tell me, where do you want to go? Backwards or forwards in time?
Filming for the new series began in July 2004, and Doctor Who Confidential was there from the start.
The new series, really, we wanted to be everything the old series was, with a great big watch of 2005 shoved into it as well, because I genuinely love the old series. Tonight is our first proper night show in London, and it's very early on in the run now. We're only sort of 5 days in. We've done 5 days in Cardiff. Now we're in London, and we're doing the big London stuff, which includes the London Eye. Whenever we come here, we want to sort of maximise it to get all the big locations, all the big touristy-type settings in the background. It's got a sense of humour like it always had. Hopefully it's less studio-bound. I think that'll be the greatest visible change in it, is that it was terribly, terribly confined in sort of three walled sets. We're doing a lot of it on location, like at least so far, I think about 70% of it's on location. So that makes the whole picture look bigger, more ambitious and more epic and more modern, frankly.
As night falls over London, the day has only just begun for Chris and Billy.
And tonight is also our first big Chris and Billy scene with the Doctor and Rose together.
Oh,
and that's
yeah.
Exciting. They've done lots of scenes so far, running about, fighting monsters and things, but tonight is the heart of it, really, which is the two of them doing dialogue.
So we're about to do a scene in front of the London Eye here, another important scene from episode one, and this is just after Rose has made her very first journey in the time machine. Not in time, but in space. So it's flown and she steps out and she's surprised that it's moved.
I lost the signal. I got so close.
We've moved. Does it fly?
Disappears there and reappears here. You wouldn't understand.
The scene at the embankment is one of the scenes where I think the Doctor starts to realise that Rose is no mere ordinary mortal, you know. He's very much familiar with kind of ape-like humans that fundamentally just scream and panic and don't understand and have no ability to sort of just take on board the fact that he's an alien, that this is a spaceship, that it's bigger on the inside than the outside.
If you are an alien, how comes you sound like you're from the north?
Lots of planets have a north.
What's a police public call box?
It's a telephone box from the 1950s. It's
a disguise.
I think it's pride, but I think he knows it's a bad disguise.
Exactly, that's what it's kind of like. It's kind of
it's a disguise.
Yeah, but it's. Yeah.
That's what we're saying about trying to justify it.
Yeah.
So if you can like wind me up about it, I'll fight me call
that. What's a police public call box?
It's a telephone box from the 1950s. It's a disguise.
Okay.
What he finds, I think, with Rose is that one, she's interested, two, she's kind of bright, she's sparky, she's not fazed by what's being thrown at her, and she's had a lot thrown at her by now. And kind of in that situation where he himself is so snowballed with the fact that he's lost the signal and he's trying to search for something and it's all going terribly wrong, and she kind of tunes into what it is he's looking for and focuses and finds something for him.
A huge metal circular structure, like a dish, like a wheel, radial, close to where we're standing. Must be completely invisible. What is it? What? Oh. Fantastic.
Russell said, I'd really like them to hold hands on the bridge and grab each other. And at that moment, there is a kind of bonding. They're in it together. He's not said to her, come with me, or he's not trying to look after her or anything. She's just part of the team. It kind of happens in that one moment.
If you could time the action so a couple of buses went past.
There's not a bus inside, look. Yes.
We wanted the Millennium Wheel, we wanted the House of Parliament, we wanted the bridge, we wanted the river, and we wanted London buses as well. But for some reason, we didn't have a bus. It became one of those nightmarish scenarios of trying to film something and being dependent on a bus coming and then trying to time the run of the actors and cue them to run at exactly the right time so that the buses came alongside them just at the kind of critical moment, which I'd like to be able to say happened very quickly, but of course it didn't.
How's that? Good.
Yeah, it's all right. Well done.
I'm sick of red London buses. They kept getting in the back of my shot.
Thing is, with someone like Chris as an actor playing the Doctor, he's such a fine actor, he's going to bring completely new qualities to it, a new alienness, a new energy, the way he walks, the way he dresses, everything. There's a brand new Chris Eccleston Doctor, and there's a whole generation of kids for whom that's going to be their definitive Doctor. But having said that, I mean, in many ways, there are lots of links with the past, partly because the Doctor's always doing the same thing. He's always saving a planet, he's always berating an alien, he's always having fun. So, you know, when he's angry, there will be the righteousness of John Pertwee in there. When he's being a bit balmy, there'll be touches of Tom Baker. It's inevitable that those things feed in.
He's got the grinning madness of Tom, but he's got the sort of vulnerability of Peter Davison.
It's like when you're a kid, the first time they tell you that the world's turning and you just can't quite believe it because everything looks like it's standing still. I can feel it.
And a little bit of that excitedness that Paul McGann brought to it.
The turn of the earth. The ground beneath our feet is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, and the entire planet is hurtling round the sun at 67,000 miles an hour, and I can feel it. We're falling through space, you and me, clinging to the skin of this tiny little world, and if we let go, that's who I am.
So in a way, you can see the other Doctors in him somewhere, which I guess, since they're all meant to be the same person, is very apt. But yeah, he's a very modern Doctor, I think.
How do you do, sir? I'm the Doctor.
Don't call me Doc. Now, do I make myself clear?
I think I always knew there was a good chance Doctor he would come back. There's still an audience, an enormous audience out there.
Eureka!
I'm the Doctor.
Who would think up a crazy notion like this?
I don't know.
Nothing has been quite like it.
Fantastic mind.
He was somebody who had two hearts and a body temperature radically different from yours and mine.
You don't happen to have an elephant gun, do you?
You know, I think since his regeneration, he's become decidedly immature.
He's an alien from Gallifrey.
He's been around for 900 years.
Not a very brave man. I'm only doing what has to be done.
He's a kind of an old-fashioned hero, in a way.
Seems to laugh at danger, but is still very, very caring.
I'll have to link in my own cerebral cortex. That's the only thing.
That is highly dangerous.
I know. Two more leads, Rogan.
He's also a bit of a rebel, the black sheep of the family.
We're always intrigued by people who have secrets.
He is wildly eccentric.
you'll see him confront a bad situation. He'll make a joke about it. He'll lighten the mood.
Would you care for a jelly, baby?
His specialist subject is the human race.
It may be irrational of me, but human beings are quite my favourite species.
Hold tight, everyone!
He's a tremendous optimist, and he sees the positive, always. The nice thing about playing him is that he cares.
Every Doctor was different, partly because every actor was different, and they tended mostly to go for actors with strong, kind of acting personalities.
The Doctor's been around for 900 years, but first appeared in 1963, when William Hartnell strode onto our screens.
The first Doctor, William Hartnell, I mean, he was a grumpy old man, and that was great.
He was, you know, in the mould of the mad inventor, really.
Let me get this straight. A thing that looks like a police box, standing in a junkyard, it can move anywhere in time and space?
Yes.
Not quite clear, is it? I can see by your face that you're not certain. You don't understand. I knew you wouldn't. Never mind.
Certainly irascible would be the adjective you used to describe him.
Doctor! Help!
Now, later.
Actors come and go, but the Time Lord is timeless.
As a kid, I remember being fascinated by the idea of regeneration, partly from a television point of view, wanting to see how they could do it, how they could change one man into another man, and yet he's essentially the same man. As a notion, that was really interesting, but also I wanted to see what the special effects would be like.
The perfect device for keeping his name but changing his face was regeneration. As William Hartnell transformed into Doctor Number Two, Patrick Troughton.
If I had to put my hand on my heart and say, OK, excluding yourself, who's your favourite Doctor? I would have to say him, because of my memories of that transformation, of being appalled that somebody else is going to play the Doctor, of realising later that in the hands of a less skillful character actor than Patrick Troughton, that would have been the end of the series.
Our lives are different to anybody else's. That's the exciting thing. Nobody in the universe can do what we're doing.
Patrick Troughton came in and did the most fantastic job. I mean, I think Patrick Troughton was my favourite Doctor because he took on, at that point, the most impossible of all of us. But, you know, he was the second one.
You will be sent to Earth in the 20th century and will remain there for as long as we deem proper.
But you can't condemn me to exile on one primitive planet in one century in time?
No!
Not only was the Doctor exiled to Earth, he was forced to regenerate and emerged from the TARDIS as John Pertwee.
And, of course, John Pertwee's dandy with his fluffy shirts and his frilly bits here, which went very much with his way of doing it.
John, not only was he a great adventurer, he was also a great gadgets man. He loved toys of all kinds. So that seemed to bleed right through into Doctor Who and sonic screwdrivers.
Bessie, how dare you go gallivanting around like that? Now go back to your parking place before I change my mind. Solenoids and a servo mechanism in Bessie, and a radio control unit here.
Whoever came up with the idea of regeneration was a genius, because it turned what could have been the end of a programme into an actual plus. It became something that people look forward to. We mourn the passing of our favourite Doctor, but, hey, there's a new guy coming along.
When they gave me the job and quickly signed the contract, they then took me out to dinner. And when it got to the coffee stage, they said, so Tom said, what are you going to do with it? And I said, I don't know. And they were a bit surprised about that, and I think maybe even a bit anxious.
Tom Baker was the fourth and longest-serving Doctor.
As for the physiognomy, well, nothing's perfect. Have to take the rough with the smooth. Mind you, I think the nose is a definite improvement.
Keeping a straight face and a straight bat was Peter Davison, Doctor Number Five.
When you're cast as Doctor, you're not cast to be the same. You are the same man, but you're cast because you're different.
So there's no way I could be like any of the other doctors, really.
When Peter arrived, Peter Davison arrived after Tom, they decided that the regeneration process would make him exhausted and helpless and weak, and he had to be looked after by his three, I think he had three companions at the time, for the first couple of episodes. So they decided that a neat contrast with that regeneration would be to have me hyper.
Cranky Colin Baker played Doctor Number 6.
You're expecting someone else?
I...
That's three eyes in one breath makes you sound a rather egotistical young lady.
For a couple of episodes, I was rushing around like some manic, selfish monster who'd been unsettled by his regeneration.
Now you see me?
The honour of the final regeneration in the 80s went to Sylvester McCoy.
Colin couldn't, or wouldn't, or and quite understandably, didn't make the transformation scene. So what they did was they dressed me up in his costume. Now, Colin is much taller than me, and a little broader as well. And I think they lost me for 3 days inside it. It was huge, and they had to roll me up and tuck it all in. And then they put a blonde wig, a curly wig, on my head. I looked like Harpo Marx.
In 1989, the series dematerialised from our screens for 7 years, only to reappear as a film, with Paul McGann as the Eighth Doctor.
I wondered at first whether he could, you know, carry it off, and he did, I thought, really well. Well, I don't think the story was the best thing. It was too complicated, too many strands in it.
I think that could have been the beginning of, you know, a long tenure for Paul, because he's certainly charismatic. He's, you know, got a great face and he's a great actor. He was settled a bit at the beginning with a regeneration that took a long time. And I think if they were trying to introduce it to a new audience, maybe the whole regeneration thing was a mistake.
In fact, they shouldn't have had me in it. What they should have had was Paul McGann in it. And then later on, if the series had been taken up, brought me in to show how it happened. But I'm glad I was in it. The money was good.
So, why no regeneration for the Ninth Doctor?
It would be madness to start with a leading man and then change him. 10 minutes in, I mean, you've got to think of this as a new programme. We're being marvellously faithful to its history and mythology. But within that, it's like you're mad if you think that at 8 years old you'd watch Paul McGann walk on screen, get hit by a laser bolt and turn into someone else. It's like every story has got to make sense emotionally. When you get to love the Ninth Doctor, Chris Eccleston, when he changes, then you will love him. Then you will feel it happening. That's when regeneration works, when you feel it.
And a 40-year-old man sitting down watching Doctor Who, I could never replace Tom Baker or John Pertwee or even Troughton or maybe even Hartnell in their hearts, because when they saw those doctors, they were children, you know. And I like that loyalty.
There you are. Now come along, Doctor. You're supposed to be in the sick bay.
Am I?
You're not fit yet.
Not fit? I'm the Doctor.
No, Doctor, I'm the Doctor, and I say that you're not fit.
You may be a Doctor, but I'm the Doctor. The definite article, you might say.
No one ever fails Doctor Who. And so I came with the goodwill of my predecessor, and he came with the goodwill of his predecessor. Ha! It's a bit like royal family, really. They go, you know, you inherit a part.
Look here, Doctor, you're not fit.
Not fit, not fit. Of course I'm fit. All systems go.
Set. Look.
What I hope is that the 8-year-olds that watch it, I'll be their first doctor. I hope they haven't seen any DVDs of anybody. Hiya.
Hi.
Nice
to meet you.
You're the Doctor.
Hiya.
Yeah,
I am. For today, I am.
Now officially the Ninth Doctor, Chris continues the long tradition of Doctor Who, which continued to thrive even when the series went off air.
One of my favourite things about the Doctor Who world is that when it went off air, the thousands of Doctor Who fans didn't let it die there.
The Doctor Who industry, I guess you could call it, has just been going on and from strength to strength ever since. In about 1991, a new range of books was started. The magazine's been running now for 25 years. There's always a comic strip in there. The Doctor Who audio adventure started in 1999.
Off you go.
Perry, what's happening? Where's Eremim?
She was just in there, but she disappeared in front of my eyes. She just melted away.
Like the TARDIS dematerialization? It's some kind of transmat device. Am I right, Butler?
You are correct, Doctor. It is a transmat.
This is the station power plant, but the transmat here is connected to the general colony systems.
Who's your metal friend?
This is Butler, and technically we're his prisoners.
We had been doing other sci-fi audio stuff, CD dramas, and then out of the blue, we got asked to go in for a meeting, and they said, hey, guys, we've heard what you do, we quite like it. How would you like to have the licence to perhaps do Doctor Who on CD? And so our first one came out in 99, and we've been bashing away at it ever since.
And also, of course, you've got DVDs and videos. So pretty much for any 1 month between the Doctor Who ending and the new series coming on, you could maybe get up to 5 or 6 separate Doctor Who stories a month, which is more than you'd ever get when it was on the telly.
Recently, there was a webcast with Richard E. Grant. There's always fan fiction and stuff like that. The fascinating thing, it's become a property that has been owned by its fans.
A handful of programmes will survive in the sense that they were seminal in BBC's history, and that's going to be one of them forever.
There's a budget of millions, an award-winning cast and crew, some of the UK's best scriptwriters, 13 episodes to make, 5 directors to shoot them, and only 10 months to film.
And action!
But at the end of the day, it all comes down to one doctor and a battered leather jacket.
Russell had scripted a leather jacket.
Really battered.
Battered leather jacket, so you get the traveller thing.
Yeah, so we tried loads and loads on, didn't we?
Yeah, it's so long back, long
ago.
Even
had one made, and do you remember? Put it on, and it was hideous, so I ripped it off. Do you remember when we started again? It was too new, wasn't it?
It was too cut.
I didn't want the costume to ever become an object where you used to think, oh, what's he wearing today? It had to be a silhouette that you were very used to. And when he's against all the other aliens, from the back or from the side, you always know it's him. His clothes shouldn't really dominate his role, they should help. So the thought of having a leather jacket is always a good bonus because it would give that appearance of an action man.
It's not something I'd wear personally, but I think it's perfect for the Doctor. Lucy did a fantastic job.
I mean, Chris's costume is very stripped down, which very much suits his Doctor. He wants the acting to come forward and be at the centre of it. But actually, if you look back, that's sort of quite a 2005 attribute, actually, something very minimalist about that. And if you look back, the Doctor's always had a sort of aspect of the age about him. Colin Baker was massively colourful, and you look at the 80s and you think, my God, that was a colourful time. In the 60s, it was much more sort of patrician with capes and stuff like that. So the Doctor's always fitted his age, really.
They seek him here, they seek him there. His clothes are loud, but never square. It will make or break him, so he's got to buy the best, 'cause he's a dedicated follower of fashion. Oh yes he is,
oh yes he is,
oh yes he is,
oh yes he is.
There's one thing that he loves, and that is flattery. One week he's in polka dots, and next week he's in stripes, 'cause he's a dedicated follower of fashion. He's a dedicated follower.
And with a new doctor comes a new companion.
You got me very funny. Right, I've got the joke.
Rob.
With a lot of the things he does, he's kind of got eyes in the back of his head, and he's weighing her up right from the start, really. And she seems to slip into his rhythm.
She just feels right to him and him to her. It's not in his nature to question things too much. He just sweeps her along, and she's able to surf it, really.
He's 900 years old, she's 19, yet they think alike. She's so astute and so kind of inquisitive that she spots things. His arm off.
Yep. Plastic.
Very clever, nice trick. Who were they then? Students?
Why would they be students?
Because to get that many people dressed up and being silly, they got to be students.
That makes sense. Well done.
Thanks. And that's what he loves about her, and that's what she loves about him. They are just partners in crime through and through. But she's not scared to challenge him equally, you know. And I think that's something that he finds quite brilliant about her.
Your choice. Tell me or I'll start talking.
Is that supposed to sound tough?
Sort of.
Doesn't work.
Who are you?
Told you, the doctor.
Yeah, but doctor what?
Just the doctor.
The doctor.
Hello.
Is that supposed to sound impressive?
Sort of.
It's such an interesting dynamic because reading the scripts, you just can't put your finger on what their relationship is actually about. And I don't think they really ever question it. They just, you know, get on with it.
They want to overthrow the human race and destroy you. Do you believe me?
No.
But you're still listening.
So the doctor's back with a new assistant, a universe full of foes, and a 50s police box to take him there. Get ready for the new series of Doctor Who.
The doctor's making house calls, then God help you.
Forget the final episode of Casanova tomorrow night at 10 on BBC Three. Next up, though, the first episode of Farscape.